From the TVW studio, it's Inside Olympia with host Austin Jenkins.
For the past 85 years, the state of Washington has had essentially the same tax system. We have a sales tax, a property tax, and a business and occupation tax, to name the three big legs of the stool, but no income tax. This system is often described as regressive because people who make less pay a higher percentage of their income in taxes than people who make more. Additionally, the B&O tax is a tax on gross receipts, not net profits, which means businesses pay the tax whether they're profitable or not. Over the decades, tax commissions, and I believe there have been 9 of them, have met to try to come up with a different system, but those studies mostly just gather dust on a shelf. Now, though, the legislature is taking a fresh look at Washington's tax system, but will this time be any different than those previous efforts? Joining me now to talk about tax reform are the co-chairs of Washington's Tax Structure Work Group, Democratic State Representative Noelle Frame, representing the majority party, and Republican State Senator Keith Wagoner, representing minority Republicans. Welcome both of you to Inside Olympia, and great to see you.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, it's been a while, and I'm happy to be here.
Well, let's start perhaps with the obvious question, which is, if this has been tried and looked at numerous times in the past over a number of decades, I certainly remember the 2002 effort led by the late Bill Gates Sr., and nothing happens, why try again? And I'll start with you, Representative Frame, because I know that the enacting legislation was your idea.
Great. Well, thanks, Austin. I appreciate the question. And it's something I thought about pretty deeply before introducing the legislation and advocating for the budget proviso ultimately. Mm-hmm. You know, as I examined past efforts, the thing that really struck me is how little engagement there was with taxpayers outside of Olympia. The past effort 20 years ago did incredible analysis, really truly deep analysis with academics. There was some degree of engagement with sort of really Olympia insiders, lobbyists, but there was very little engagement out with the broader public. When we started this effort several years ago and went on the road in 2018 and just did 4 meetings in Spokane, Yakima, Vancouver, Seattle, there was such a desire to have the conversation and people were really appreciative that we came to them. And so when we reauthorized this, we built in not just the analysis, not just the conversations amongst ourselves, but work that will happen in 2021 to go out and talk to a broad set of taxpayers, to talk to them about the code, the tax code that we have, mm-hmm. and the tax code that maybe we could have as we seek to look at alternatives. So that's really what motivated me, Austin.
And Democrats have talked about trying to change the tax code for a long time. Senator Wagoner, is there a desire and an interest on the part of Republicans to change our system? Or are you into this co-chair role more to be to play defense and to try to, in essence, keep what we have?
Yeah, I wouldn't characterize my role as defensive, but just a moderating factor, perhaps. Mm-hmm. I don't think anyone believes that we have a perfect tax structure. Mm-hmm. So the idea that it needs to change is fairly obvious. And the fact that we haven't had success in past attempts to reach a consensus on what that change would look like is not a good reason to not keep trying. I was brought into this role by Representative Frame, which I appreciate, to hopefully provide some balance, I guess. I mean, we obviously both have different philosophical angles from which we're coming from this. But right now, I think it's important to bring out the point that we're just in an education stage for the most part, reaching out to people who are very aware of tax structure, and later in 2021, we're going to be reaching out to people who are paying the taxes. And I think that's just an important learning process as we go forward to see if we can craft something and come up with ideas that will be popular on both sides of the aisle. Certainly, that's my goal.
It seems like, Representative Frame, that the public might be able to understand or accept sort of on paper that our tax system is not built for our modern economy. It certainly was built more for a manufacturing economy, and we're more of a service-based economy now. But they might also say, you know, I'm not sure I trust those politicians. I'm not sure I trust Olympia. I might stick with the devil I know than be that open to radical change.
Yeah, and I think that's why it's so important that we look at this structurally and that we're really looking at change all at the same time. And honestly, we need to give our taxpayers tools to really understand the code. It's complicated. This, they elect us to take care of this, right? Like, they want us to know and understand the tax policy, but we have to do the work it takes to help bring them along as well. And one of the things that I'm looking forward to, I haven't seen it yet, Senator Wagoner and I haven't seen it, but we've been told by the consultants that are working with the Department of Revenue, for instance, that they're building a tax calculator so that as we select alternative tax codes that we want to take out to the public and gather their feedback on, we might actually be able to do it where a member of the public, a taxpayer, could go to the website for the tax structure work group, a new one will be launched right after the first of the year, and could put in their own tax liability and look at what their tax liability might be under the various alternative tax codes. That's the level of engagement and conversation we simply have not had in Washington State in past efforts as we look to change the tax structure. So I think that that's one part of it. For people to see the whole picture at once could really be a motivator for change.
And Senator Wagoner, do you, what's your sense of the appetite or the interest that the public might have? And again, that sort of trust factor that if, and it's a big if, but if, mm-hmm. if legislators, perhaps in bipartisan fashion, could ever get to the point where they go to taxpayers and say, here's our best recommendation, how do you think that would land?
Well, I think the public is wise to be skeptical. Certainly taxes have never seemed to reduce. And nobody wants to pay more. But I think that if we can present this in a way that has broad support across the aisle, and we can present it to the public in a way that Representative Frame just described through modeling, we can gain some confidence. You know, I'm skeptical myself of where this might go. We're working with a complicated system, and it would be one thing if you were just starting out with a blank slate and there wasn't existing tax code, but we're kind of coming into this like a Jenga game where we have to move one piece and hope that that doesn't affect the whole rest of the structure and it all comes crumbling down. So we have to be very careful and thoughtful when we shift tax burden. We were careful, or I should say the legislation was careful, to make this pretty much a revenue neutral model that we're working towards, which I greatly appreciate because I don't want to see a big increase in spending just because we can. But it'll be a tough sell, I think, if we come to conclusions that we can agree on. It'll be a tougher sell if we're divided at the end of the day in this process.
Well, Representative Frame, the income tax has sort of been often described as a third rail of politics in Washington state, but it's also very hard to have a conversation about robust tax reform without considering that. And I note that it is certainly a part of the conversation that this task force is having. There is quite a robust amount of information and discussion, it looks like, on a personal income tax. So where does that piece fit into this conversation and perhaps into a future tax structure in this state?
So I really think that where we're going to come down at the end of the day is less about the personal income tax and more about the corporate income tax. So we've talked a lot about the business and occupation tax. It's a tax on gross receipts. So every dollar that comes through the door of a business is taxed, whether they're profitable or not. There is a strong, strong desire, bipartisan desire to change that. And that's reflected, I will tell you, our tax exemptions that we have in the state. We were at 748 as of the last tax exemption study. We forego $68 billion of revenue as a consequence, which is more than we collect each biennium. Nearly 400 of those are just on the B&O tax because it's so inequitable. And we have modeled three potential alternatives to B&O tax, a value-added tax, a margins tax, or a net receipts tax, AKA a corporate income tax. And honestly, when we looked at the presentation on Friday, one of the big, I think, questions of tax administration that we're going to have to consider is if we wanted to move to a corporate income tax, which I think there's a lot of interest in the business community. Certainly B&O is the devil they know, and there's a level of comfort with it, but it would be better in many cases to go to a corporate income tax. I don't know that we have an example of states that have a corporate income tax, but not also a personal one. And we found out why. The problem with that is that we can build a corporate income tax on C corporations, but if we want to have a corporate income tax for S corporations, partnerships, LLCs, et cetera, I don't think we have another state that does that without a personal income tax. So that's a bit of a quandary for us. Now, if we go with a value-added tax or a margins tax, this isn't as much of an issue. So it's really a matter and question of, I think, tax policy, tax administration, and simplicity. Certainly in terms of finding revenue that would help make the tax code more equitable, vertically equitable, as we talk about in the tax principles, to get at that issue of regressivity on the personal side. We have plenty of other options that we could pursue beyond a personal income tax, but I think we're gonna have to think about it in the context of trying to finally fix the tax code for our business community.
So, and I'll come back to personal income tax in a moment, but Senator Wagoner, let me ask you about this notion of just the B&O tax. And it does seem like the one area of our, you know, the one leg of the stool, and maybe property tax as well, but the one leg of the stool where you really could find bipartisan agreement, because the business community, as I understand it, by and large, isn't thrilled with the B&O tax. It benefits some. We often hear that Boeing benefits from it, but many others do not. So what's your thinking about replacing it with a corporate income tax or one of these other ideas?
I think it has great potential, and particularly because the B&O tax, it doesn't even pass common sense in some respects. The fact that it's on gross instead of net means struggling businesses can be losing money and still owe the state their burden of the tax share. So that crushes some early businesses early on. And we know about 50% of businesses fail within the first 4 or 5 years. I think that is a factor in Washington state. So it makes a lot more sense just in fairness that you would tax profits rather than everything they have. And there's some carve outs that don't make sense. As it gets more and more complicated, certain groups can find a way out of it. I think those holes need to be plugged, but it needs to be plugged in a way that helps businesses grow and succeed in Washington. So I think there is potential in that area, and but I would like to speak to the personal income tax. Yeah. You said you were going
back. Yeah, that's a kick. Yeah, and I definitely want to come back to that. Let me just ask about a strategy question first, though. Representative Frame, are you thinking about tax reform as sort of a omnibus overhaul, or might it work to do this? And I use the word piecemeal, but not as a bad thing. But let's say you could get some alignment or agreement around a new business tax. Could the legislature do that as a starting point, for instance? Or is everything so kind of inextricably linked that you really can't do one without the other?
Yeah, and Austin, this is what I was alluding to a minute ago. So on Friday, we were given the presentation of the analysis that's been happening over the last 18 months, the economic modeling. And we had asked them to tell us the answer to, could we simply swap out the B&O tax for a corporate income tax, again, to move from a gross receipts to a true net receipts tax? And the answer to that question is, if we made that move in a silo and did nothing else, our corporate income tax rate would be 15.4%, which of course would be the highest in the nation. It would make us incredible. It would just make us uncompetitive. So we simply cannot solve the B&O problem in its own silo, which is why we have to look at everything at the same time. Now, I will say there were some really good ideas, and Senator Wagoner and I spoke to the Tax and Fiscal Policy Committee of the Association of Washington Business yesterday, and there was a suggestion about stretching out implementation by some number of years. That makes a lot of sense to me, that we can pass change and keep the current structure in place over a period of time while we're transitioning to the new one, while we get the regulations figured out. That makes a lot of sense to me. And so perhaps that is some way to accommodate the answer to your question as well.
Okay, yeah, no, that helps a lot. Senator Wagoner, let's do talk about the income tax here. Is that absolutely a non-starter for Republicans in this state, sort of over your dead body, that this would happen? Or can you look at a state like Idaho and say, you know, they've got an income tax that's a conservative state, low rates, maybe this could work in Washington state?
Well, I'll tell you, you described it as a third rail, and my natural inclination is the over my dead body reaction. However, I committed to Representative Frame that I would be open-minded and listen at least to all of the options, and that's what I've done. Now, it's important to remember that the public, our constituents, the people who put us here, have weighed in on this issue many times and to the negative. It's also important to remember we all swore an oath to uphold the Constitution, and as that stands right now, it's not constitutionally possible. So in a theoretical sense, I'm listening to all the presentations and I'm looking at the numbers and I'm trying to keep an open mind. And then I'm also naturally disinclined to go in that direction. And I think it would be a very hard sell. There would have to be very strong protection, sideboards, backstops, whatever you want to call it, for anything like that to get bipartisan support. Because as we talked about earlier, what's the level of trust of the public that once an income tax was installed, it wouldn't just be abused and the rates would go up and up and up and up as we see in other places. So I'm cautiously looking at the possibilities and trying to keep an open mind, but it's going to be a very, very hard sell.
And Representative Frame, you know that there are certainly Democrats who have talked openly about the idea of an income tax. I believe that Bill Gates, not senior, suggested earlier this year that it might be time in Washington to do that. You, when I asked you the question the first time, immediately talked about the corporate income tax idea, but where are you in your thinking at this point, and where are Democrats when it comes down to the personal income tax? I imagine you're not taking it absolutely off the table for purposes of this conversation.
Certainly not. And you know, I think what Senator Wagoner said is, again, we are having a conversation with the public. And, you know, the conversation that has been had with the public for many years about an income tax has really been through the lens of it being a political weapon. It is probably the most weaponized political issue in the state of Washington and has been for a long time. And I think when people actually take a step back, put their weapons down, and think about public policy and what is in the best interest for the people of the state of Washington, that's where suddenly it can maybe come back onto the table. And I do say maybe. And this is, again, why I think it is important that it is talked about in the context of so many other pieces of tax policy. On Friday, again, when our consultants in the Department of Revenue presented us with some modeling, they told us, here's some potential ways that this could look. So I gave you the example of corporate income tax. They gave us another couple of examples where they said, you could do corporate income tax and personal income tax, and you could reduce the sales tax by 3 percentage points, and you could eliminate the state portion of the property tax, which I think would be wildly popular with the people of Washington state. If you did all that, that corporate and personal income tax rate would be 4.75%, which is still lower than our neighboring states of Oregon and Idaho, which, you know, from a matter of competitiveness and border leakage, which our border cities like Spokane and Vancouver worry about a lot, you know, people moving sales tax, reducing that sales tax would be very attractive to our border cities. So, you know, to you're asking a lot of questions about trust, Austin. That is the type of options we want to put before the public that shows them the big picture all at once, so that they can have that confidence that if we are adding a new revenue source, that other revenue sources, other taxes are going to go down. But I will say, and I was asked this question many times in the beginning of the process, this is not just some effort to get an income tax on the books. There are other options that we have that could raise revenue and help us reduce the sales tax, reduce or eliminate the state portion of the property tax. This is not a done deal. It's not baked. We have a long road of public engagement ahead of us. So I hope we continue to put down those political weapons and have open public policy conversations. We could, of course, have a flat income tax today. The progressive piece is what is prevented by the uniformity clause of the state constitution. And I think we need to think about both of those options as we move forward, only in conversation with the public.
Well, and Senator Wagoner, this idea that it's been weaponized, or that maybe it's just anathema to Washington voters because we've never had it. And it's, you know, we compare to Oregon, right? We have the sales tax, they have the income tax. We do things differently. That's the way it's always been. It's been for decades. People are a little bit reluctant to change. On the other hand, is there something about the way that Representative Frame just sold it that maybe there could be something in it for the taxpayer? We get rid of that state portion of the property tax. We lower that sales tax, which is now double digits in some counties when you add in the local. And if you could build those sideboards around the income tax that you talked about, and again, I go back to Idaho, which is not a blue West Coast state. If it works there, why might not it work in Washington State?
So I think if you could build those sideboards, that would then become the new starting point for discussion. And I also want to throw out the fact that I believe that a capital gains tax is an income tax. So I throw that out there as well. But to be fair to Representative Frame's argument, if you could make a dramatic cut in property taxes, that's something that really affects my constituents. And I see as a problem with our tax code, the fact that property taxes continue to go up at a time when people who are retired or elderly and their earnings drop off doesn't make sense to me. So there are ways that you could modulate the effect of an income tax. That's not the same thing as me saying I support it. But I think that if you could put all those protections in place and also get trust that there wasn't going to be some change the next legislative session, that would be a good place to start.
Yeah. And again, I'm not trying to, I understand you guys are in this period and it's a multi-year effort to try to get kind of your arms around this and understand what the options would be. And so trying to pin you down on a specific policy is not my goal, given the context of this conversation. It's interesting to sort of hear how thinking might be evolving or what the realm of possibilities might be. At the same time, I want to be very specific here because Senator Wagoner just mentioned the capital gains tax, Representative Frame, and that is something that has been proposed and even passed in at least one of the chambers in recent years. Where does that idea fit into this conversation? And my double-barreled question is the capital gains tax back on the agenda for 2021?
The capital gains tax is most certainly on the agenda for 2021. And I will tell you what is so, people ask me this all the time, like, well, shouldn't we just wait until your work is done in the tax structure work group to make any changes? And I will tell you, because we are confident that the capital gains tax will be challenged in court, it would be frankly delightful to see that in any other tax policy that may be challenged in court. It'd be nice to have it passed this year so that we have the time for those legal proceedings to get themselves worked out, so that by the time that we come back in the 2023 session, we know what our real options are. I don't want to pass structural reform based on tax policy that we don't know if it's going to hold up in court or not. So frankly, I'm kind of not so secretly hoping it does get passed this year, it gets itself worked out, and we know what, you know, tools we have in the tool chest as we look at structural reform with these proposals that we will come forward with for the 2023 session. So that is my hope.
We should probably take just a moment to explain the potential constitutional issues around a capital gains tax or an income tax. The Supreme Court did weigh in on this, I believe, in the 1930s, but there seems to be some question about what the court today would say if this came back before it. Representative Frame, just briefly, can you explain why advocates think that this is even possible, while also acknowledging that it likely would lead to a court fight? Like, why is there a thought that you could prevail?
You got it. So for big context, the court ruling that you're referring to deemed income is property, and property is subject to the state's uniformity clause, which means that taxes have to be assessed uniformly, and you cannot have, for instance, a progressive or graduated tax rate for income tax, property tax, etc. That was the ruling back in the 1930s. I believe capital gains tax is an excise tax. It is a tax on a transaction, the sale of stocks, bonds, etc. Others believe that because it appears on the federal income tax, I guess 1040, that it is an income tax. This is what the courts are going to have to decide. We have a difference of opinion of how that should be classified. But we, the legislators, are not going to make that decision. The courts will. So that's why we're talking about letting it get passed, challenged, and go to the courts and have that decided.
So Senator Wagoner, on the personal income tax, would a flat rate tax not pass constitutional muster?
I don't think that it would. And if I could expound a little bit on what Representative Frame just said on the, I think the argument that this is just some sort of archaic court ruling from the 1930s that hasn't been revisited is not quite the whole picture. There are many opinions, contemporary opinions, coming out of the government that say it is an income tax. I think that is an absolute fact, at least from my perspective. And without disparaging the courts, I have to say that they have consistently ruled in ways that I think are counter to logic. So I'm a little fearful that the court would just sail this on through on ideological grounds rather than on legal grounds. So I don't doubt what the Representative Frame says that is coming, but if it, I will certainly be against it at this point in time. I agree with your earlier characterization that why not wait until we get it all straightened out? I think that would be much better timing and much less controversial.
Okay, we have about a minute left. And so Representative Frame, could I just ask you about the timeline here? You mentioned 2023 as the session. I also saw a date of a December 31st, 2024 final report. What, just for the public and for the taxpayer, what sort of timeline are you operating on?
Great. So at the end of this year, we'll have the preliminary report that summarizes all the economic modeling that's been done over the last 18 months. In 2021, we will, as a tax structure work group, come up with taxing model alternatives to take out to the public to ask for feedback. And that engagement with the public will happen in 2021. In 2022, we will work internally to come up with legislative proposals incorporating that feedback that we've received from taxpayers to be brought forward in the 2023 session. We also built in the original kind of thinking about this, an idea that if we did not succeed in 2023, we do another round of public engagement in 23, try again with a fine-tuned proposal in 2024, and the whole effort would close out at the end of 2024. And if we are not successful at the end of 2024, well, we will let another group take a run at it in the future, but hopefully we'll be successful.
And then just a last comment from each of you, just about your level of optimism, I guess that's the right word, that this conversation, this effort, and it's a multi-year effort, will lead to something other than a report that sits on the shelf as the last several tax commission efforts have. Senator Wagoner, do you want to take that first?
Yeah, I'm very confident that this is going to lead to some action. And because we've reached out to so many stakeholders and we've spread the process out in a thoughtful way, I'm a little bit concerned about next year because we're doing things virtually. I talked about this with Association of Washington Businesses last night. It has the effect of keeping the public out of the process. Internet problems, people who don't have availability to internet, the fact that everything is being done remotely causes me a little bit of trepidation going forward that we're not gonna involve the people of the state the way that they deserve to be involved. So I think that's a barrier, and maybe it's better to slow down and get things right than it is to try and get through dates that we've set on a calendar.
Okay, and Representative Frame, are the ghosts of tax commissions past haunting you in the night and saying, don't do this, it will never go anywhere?
Not at all, Austin. And you know, I think we are going to have to think very intentionally about reimagining what the public engagement looks like moving forward, because of course we couldn't have anticipated a pandemic and doing everything remote. But, you know, I think it presents us some new and interesting opportunities. I think hopefully by the fall of 2021, the vaccine will be out. We'll be able to do in-person meetings again. And so I don't think we will not have any in-person meetings, but we need to be thoughtful and creative. And, you know, I'll tell you, I'm the vice chair of the Human Services and Early Learning Committee in the House. During committee days last week, we had a committee work session that was presented live interpretation in five languages through that tool on Zoom that I didn't even know existed. And that to me gives me some optimism that maybe, yes, we need to push back that in-person engagement, but we have some options that we never knew possible to engage a broader set of individuals that maybe never could have come out to a public meeting because they work on a weekend or they have childcare issues, et cetera. So I'm optimistic that the public is going to engage deeply in this conversation. They have shown to date that they are interested, and I'm looking forward to the next bit of conversation.
Okay, State Representative Noelle Frame, State Senator Keith Wagoner, the co-chairs of this tax studies, I should say, state tax structure work group.